Viewing by internet or TV, we welcome you here this morning. A little bit different setting. You are with us for the first time at our 8:30 contemporary service. So we thank you for joining us. We have a few announcements to make here this morning. First of all is we need help with the undecorating. It is that time to take down the Christmas decorations. If you can help this coming Saturday at 9 o'clock, PM, that's January 9th at 9 a.m., we're going to go ahead and take down the unhanging of the greens, I guess is what we would call it. We're going to take down the Christmas decorations. That'd be great to have you help us. Also, Chili Luncheon Fumcat fundraiser. Fumcat stands for, where's Kim? Kim, why don't you tell us what Fumcat stands for? All right.
Any ladies who'd like to take part in our Secret Sister, basically it's a prayer ministry, but we'll give a little gifts also. The only gifts that we would require you to give would be on a person's birthday and Christmas. So there's a guideline sheet, but there's also like your favorites and your prayer requests and that kind of thing. So if anybody wants to be part of it, there's some forms on the back table and there's some outside of the office and we'll open the prayer table.
All right, thanks, Kim. Also, membership classes start on Monday, January 11th. I don't have a time on that for sure yet, but if you're interested in joining the church, membership classes will start January 11th, and you can talk with Pastor Ed about that. He'll fill you in on what that involves. All right, any other announcements for this morning? All right, let's bow our heads together and we will enter into prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful that we can be here this morning, to be called your children, to be here in your presence, and to be surrounded with your people. God, we are here to lift up your name, to worship you, to give thanks to you, and God, we remember what it is that you've done for us. You've provided life for us, God, and we are so thankful for that. God, we sing and we give back to you just out of the gratitude of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand together. Even heroes fall down. Mountains won't last forever. Your promise never fails. When the ocean is raging, I find stillness in your presence. I lift my voice to say, Jesus, take me away. Carry me on your back. Storm, Lord, carry me on your back. You're free, storm, Lord. When the furnace is burning, I know rescue is coming. Your promise never fails. Darkness, your light shines, breaking over the horizon. Lift my eyes to see, heaven's fighting for me. Carry me on your back, through the storm, Lord. Carry me on your back, through the storm, Lord. Through the storm, Lord. take a moment to greet each other? The children to come forward at this time for this morning's children's moment. All right. Come on down. Good morning. I've got... I've got something over here I have to retrieve. Yeah, we're going to go hunting this morning. You guys want to go hunting? Rifle season's over, but there's still an archery season in here. Come on up. Come on up. Let's have a seat up here. See what we have here. Do you guys know what this is? It's a bow and arrow. You guys ever shoot a bow and arrow before? Yeah? Yeah? Anybody want to take a try this morning with it? You do? Where should we set this target? We'll use this for the target. Does that sound like a good idea? Yeah? All right, let's go. Let's set it right down here. We'll do this, but I'm not going to leave this in front of the congregation. We'll shoot this way. That's right, hunter safety course, all right? All right, come on down. Who wants to give it a try? Come on down. We'll give it a try here. All right, you ready, Raymond? Okay, there you go. Whoa, close, pretty close. Not bad. That looks like how I shoot sometimes. You want to give it a try, Lucas? Here you go. Yeah, either way. Yeah, I like that. Get that arrow on a string. I had to put a new knock on it. These knocks it came with just weren't very good. Yeah. Oh! Hold on a second. We can make this work. Let's make this work. This is Joe Porcinelli's bow, by the way, anyhow. Okay. Here, now let's try. Just pinch onto the green thing right there. Hold your hand on here. There you go. And then use this hand and grab a hold of the green part. Just the green part. Just here like this. Just pinch it like this. You see how I've got it there? There you go. Just like there you go. Now let it go. That's a pretty good try. Does anybody else want to give it a shot? No? All right. Well, I want to talk to you about this morning. It's kind of hard to hit that target up there, isn't it? Yeah, especially with Joe Porcinelli's hunting bow here. But I forgot this is on TV. But to hit that target, everything's got to happen just right. And if we were all to take a shot at that, probably more often than not, we'd miss, right? Well, life's a little bit like that. A lot like that. Life's a lot like that. And God gives us instructions on what we should do. And it seems like a lot of times we just can't get it done, right? We miss. We miss the mark, or we miss the target, or we don't get done what we're supposed to get done. And you guys want to know what that word for that is called in sin when we don't do what we're supposed to do? Or in life when we're not supposed to do what we're supposed to do? What's that word called? Sin? Yeah, that's actually an archery term. Yeah, to miss the mark. Yep, that's where that word comes from. And kind of this is the neat part about it. That's where Jesus steps in. You know, we celebrated Jesus' birth here just a couple weeks ago when we're still in the Advent season. And Jesus showed up because we couldn't hit the mark. And he lived a perfect life, and he did it because we couldn't. And that's where we get our forgiveness, is through Jesus. So I think it's pretty neat to remember that even though we can't be perfect, that there was somebody that was perfect, and he stands in our place to give us forgiveness. That's pretty neat, isn't it? All right, let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to go off to, well, before we do that, we have a collection here, but then we're going to go off to junior church or the nursery. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that in our shortcomings, God, that you step in, and that's where we can lean on you, rely on you, and trust in you, God, that you've paid the penalty for our sin, and that you've made us perfect through your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's grab a basket, and we'll go around and we'll have our children's collection.
Sometimes I believe all the lies. So- should despise. And every day I am swayed by whatever is on my mind. I hear it all depends on my face, so I'm feeling precarious. The only problem I have with these mysteries is they're so mysterious.
Would the ushers please come forward at this time for this morning's receiving of the tithing offering?
Who? Kim Smith, Leah Onley, and myself are going to be singing here in the early service, and then Debbie Kalasik is going to be singing with us in the second service. We'll stand up here so the choir mics can pick us up.
Why don't you stand in the middle there?
All right. And Michael's going to give us, this is going to be an a cappella song, so Michael's going to give us the chord to get started out on. Yep. For this morning's sharing of concerns and sharing of praises. First, I want to point out that we have a little white rose on the altar this morning, and that is in celebration of a new baby we've had this last week. New Year's Eve, Amy, Atkins, Amy, and Jeremy had a little boy named Jay. They named him JJ. This is would be Wendy and Tim Westcott's daughter and son-in-law. And I know how excited they are because they've really been wanting a baby. And so they had him on New Year's Eve, and it's kind of funny because she's a planner, like my wife's a planner, and we were out Christmas caroling there a week before Christmas, and she was bound and determined that she was going to have this baby before the first of the year. I don't know if it's for tax reasons or what it was for, but but she was bound and determined, so I told her I was going to hit every pothole. I was driving the church van that night, and I said, I'll hit every pothole I can and have a reason for my reckless driving. Well, it didn't happen, and it didn't happen. She was due Christmas Eve, and it didn't happen. And then New Year's Eve, it happened at 6 o'clock with about 6 hours to spare. So she took it right down to the wire. But we're really excited for Amy and Jeremy and their new little baby JJ. Anybody else? What's going on this week? Got to talk with Bruce Roman here a little bit earlier this morning. I know he's been getting beat up pretty bad this last week. He was in. Is he up here now? Yeah. Oh, be continuing to pray for Bruce. He's been getting it. And I asked him if he's starting to feel a little bit like Job because he was in for kidney stones last week, and then they had a fire out to the camp this week, and he's had surgery on his hand. So I was out at Roman's here. Oh, a month or so ago, and I was visiting with him, and he told me I needed to get out of there because if I hung around the Romans too long, I was liable to come down with something. So be praying for Bruce and their family.
If you could keep Lisa and myself in prayer, we are heading in tomorrow. You guys are probably tired of hearing about this because that's all I've been talking about. Well, we're heading in tomorrow morning for a C-section for our little girl to be born, and if I see him a little bit distracted this morning, it's because I'm nervous as all get out. second time through this, you think? Seneca, UPMC Seneca. Yep. You think the second time through this would be a little bit easier, but maybe it's because I know what to expect now. But a little bit nervous. So be praying for us and that everything would be okay, that Lisa would be fine and that the baby would be okay. Really appreciate that. Anybody else? All right, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for watching over us. And God, that we know that we don't have to go through this world alone, that you're right here with us. And God, we see a lot of lives in pain and people that are in the hospital and people suffering loss. God, I pray for healing and for comfort. And God, we also see a lot of lives that are celebrating because of new life, because of answered prayers, and because of restored relationships. And God, all the ways that you've blessed us. And God, we are so thankful that you care about what's going on in our personal lives. God, we ask that you would be with folks that are recovering from surgery, folks that are traveling, and God would also be with folks that seem like there's no hope. God, we know that your Son Jesus Christ offers life. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Microphone turned on here. All right. Well, Pastor Ed, talked with him Tuesday night, and he said, hey, I think you're going to have to do the service this Sunday. I said, all right. He said, I'm going in for surgery on Thursday night. He said, the doctor doesn't think I'll be in any kind of shape to preach and to be up moving around Sunday morning. So he said, I think I'm going to have you do it. And I said, fair enough. And after I talked to him yesterday, I would have to agree. The doctor was right. He still sounds pretty sore. And when I talked to Joy on Friday, she said he's really sore on Friday. That had been a day after the surgery. So I think it was a good call. And I'll do my best here this morning. Now, I do have to admit, you'd think I would have learned by now in life. And I've even heard Joe say it here, Joe Gianni say it here a few weeks ago, that a lot of times have a tendency to go ahead and do what we think we ought to be doing and then ask God to be a part of it later. So that happened to me a little bit this week. I talked to Pastor Ed, and I said, yeah, I'll do the sermon. So I said, I'll probably preach lectionary. Went home, looked at the lectionary scripture for this week. Lectionary, is a liturgical calendar that the Protestant church follows. And it's kind of neat because you can be away from your home church on any given Sunday, and if the churches follow a lectionary calendar, you can hear the same message that your home church would have preached on. So a lot of the same churches will share that calendar, and so you can have some unity throughout the year with the sermons. So I went home and got that ready, got the bulletin to Kim, and got everything ready, started working on the finer points about it, and I thought, you know what, I haven't even prayed about this yet. Maybe a good time to pray about what I'll be preaching on. So I started praying about it, and yesterday I had to write a different sermon. So I'm not going to be preaching on what is in the bulletin. So sorry, Kim, thanks for getting that around. But the scripture that's in the bulletin, Matthew 2, a very interesting section of scripture, and I would still challenge you and encourage you to read that on your own time this week, because really a neat story. And you could ask yourself the question, why people do what we do, when you read that section. But today, I'm not going to be reading or preaching on Matthew 2. I'm going to be preaching on something a little bit different than that. And I'm going to be preaching on sin, the universal language. Sin is a word that's not real popular in church these days. It's something we try to skirt around. We have different words we try to use instead of sin. I'm going to preach on it this morning, and hopefully from a little bit different angle than what we've heard recently. First thing I want to do is start out with just some biblical words for sin, and I won't go through all of them. There's all different kinds of Hebrew and Greek words that we get our word sin from. But the first word is raha, and it's used 600 times in the Old Testaments in Hebrew, and it's often translated as evil or bad, and it carries the implication of something that is contrary to God's nature. There's another word, cha'aha. This term is used almost 300 times and is most often translated as sin or offense, and it carries the implication of that which is deserving of punishment. There's a word, rasha. This term is used more than 250 times and is most often translated as wicked, and it carries the idea that something is morally wrong. The word Avon has nothing to do with the Avon sales, but it could be a slight connection here, I don't know. This term is used more than 200 times and it is more often translated as iniquity. And it carries the implication of being perverse, crooked, or twisted. And these terms go on and on. And if you read further, you can find one that has the idea of rebellion, one that means to trespass or to stagger, to go astray, to deceive, to break away, to quarrel, offend, rebel, revolt, transgress, to stray, to sin through ignorance. Violation, impiety, wickedness, ungodly, the list goes on. And finally, I want to, the last would be a Greek word, hamartin, and that means to miss the mark. Now, I'm not going to read all of those, but as you can see, the Bible talks numerous times about sin. I'm going to read you a story. When I was in high school, I was a staff shooter for a local archery store. I traveled the area on weekends and shot at local competition wearing my sponsor's business name and logo on my shirt. I wasn't Olympic status, but I was better than average. Even as a senior in high school, my teammate and I managed to place first in a winter archery league against 80 other adult competitors. I was starting to feel quite proud of my abilities and accomplishments. And then it happened. My pride was literally shattered on a hot summer afternoon during a customer appreciation day when many of the area's great shooters were there to snicker as my arrow struck a steel plate designed to fragment a high-speed arrow into as many pieces as a family-sized box of Good and Plenty. I wasn't proud, but it was good for me. I realized that I wasn't the poster child for the next best thing, as I had dreamed up in my mind. The intended target was a foam turkey surrounded by a ring of steel that announced with a loud ring that the arrow had missed its mark. When you hear your own arrow hit that steel and you realize that you have missed the mark, your stomach sinks and your heartbeat escalates and you feel more pressure in the next shot. It is interesting that we get the term sin from archery. It is an archer's term. It literally means to miss the mark. And Romans 3:23 says that everyone has sinned and that we have all missed the target. When you miss the mark or sin in a steel turkey archery competition, you ruin your arrows. But even worse than that is when you sin in life. How do you know if you've missed the mark? Judge for yourself the Ten Commandments. Have you ever told a lie? I don't really have to ask you if it was right or wrong, do I? You know that it was wrong. God says that He has written His law on your conscience. You know that murder is wrong, that stealing is wrong, and that lusting is wrong. No one has to tell you. The Bible tells us that because we have missed the mark of what God's Word has told us to do, there will be a consequence. Like the arrow that missed its mark and paid the price, we too will have to pay a price one day. When we are judged by the steel hard truth of God's perfect law, we will be found to have missed the mark. And just like the wages that we earn from our performance at work, there's also a wage that is earned for our sin. Romans 6:23 tells us that the wage of sin is death. Just as sure as we are to die a physical death and leave this body behind, we are also condemned to die a spiritual death and suffer an eternal separation from our Creator. Lucky for us, there's a comma partway through that verse 23. Up until this, we are left with a rather dismal outlook on our existence. The second half of the verse tells us about a gift. The gift is a free gift from God, and He offers us eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. It is for this very reason that the gospel is referred to as the good news. So here we are, all in the same boat, with the inability to inherit the kingdom of heaven because of our sin, when Jesus shows up and offers us life through Him. He tells us that no one comes to the Father except through Him. And Paul tells us that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Because of Jesus' death on our behalf, all we have to do is believe in Him, trusting His death as the payment for our sins, and we will be saved. Romans 10:13 says it again, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sins and rescue us from eternal death. Salvation, the forgiveness of sins, is available to anyone who will trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. When we come to church on Sunday, and you know why we come to church on Sunday, don't you? And not any other day of the week. And it isn't just because Sunday is the first day of the week, and we want to give our best and first to God. It is because Sunday is the day that Jesus rose from the dead. And it is the day that we are celebrating His resurrection from the grave and our resurrection from sin. So when we come to church on Sunday, what if it looked more like a celebration of what Jesus has done for us and not merely how we can strive to hit the target one more time? We can't hit it with any amount of regularity, and no amount of law is going to improve that fact. Maybe that is why this walk with God is called Christianity and not law-ianity. It is a life with Christ and because of Christ, and a life that is worthy of celebration. And while sin is our universal language, there is also a forgiveness and love that speaks directly to our heart that each one of us can understand when Jesus enters the picture. Now, some of my favorite preachers are what would be called holiness preachers. And this is kind of a different message than what I would normally share. But Chuck Swindoll says, you know, when you present grace, unless you present grace in a manner that it can be taken advantage of, then you haven't presented grace. And I know that the Bible talks about the disciplines of a Christian, and the Bible talks about obedience. But we also see where that got the Pharisees when they focused in on the law rather than grace. And I think what happens with us, with myself anyhow, is that when I get so focused on hitting the mark every time, and then I do hit the mark from time to time, what I end up having is a love for myself because I've earned it myself. And when we can step back and realize that it isn't about what I can do or what I have done to earn favor with Christ, because I know that I'm a filthy wretch. And that if we can focus on what it is that Christ has done for us, then our love will be with Christ. And there's a difference. And so I ask the question, what if when we come to church on a Sunday, if it's a celebration of what Christ has done for us rather than what I can do to make myself more presentable to Christ? And I think once we have that mentality shift or that mindset shift in our life that it's not about what I can do, it's about what Christ has done, that we actually have a reason for celebration. And I wanted to present this to you this morning because we can get so caught up with the finer details and a lot of the deep thinking and really interesting stuff of Christianity and forget the main point. And the main point is what Christ has done for us. And if you've never had an opportunity to invite the Lord into your heart, I want to use this time right now to do that. We've walked through a little bit of what would be called the Romans Road, where Paul talks about understanding or recognizing our sin and confessing that sin to Jesus and asking the Lord to come in and to be our Savior and to be able to trust in Jesus, knowing that what He's done for us is sufficient. That what Christ did on the cross is the only thing that I need for salvation. So let's bow our heads, and we're going to take a moment to go before the Lord here and just reflect on where we are, who we are, and who it is that Christ says He is, and who it is that I believe He is. If you'd like to use this moment to as an opportunity to ask the Lord into your heart, then pray with me. Heavenly Father, I know that I've sinned, that I've missed the mark, and I fell short. And God, I know that You sent Your Son Jesus Christ to pay the wages that I deserve, that spiritual death. God, I ask for forgiveness through Your Son Jesus Christ, and I ask You to be my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm excited for you. If you prayed that prayer for the first time and asked the Lord into your heart, you are a new believer, and the Bible says that the angels in heaven are rejoicing with us here. We're going to have one more song to sing, if I could ask the band to come forward at this time.
Let's all stand together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Friends.